Today, we'll be taking the realism of our randomly generated planets to the next level by achieving infinite resolution without hurting performance and simulating millions of years of continental drift and hydraulic erosion. But first, you guys suggested some changes to my tectonic plate simulation, like splitting up the plates into oceanic and continental. As you can see from Earth's map, a lot of plates are either entirely land or entirely ocean. First off, I increased the overall amount of land on our planet, and now I can just shift all the land on our oceanic plates downwards, so what used to be mountains now shows up as islands. Now continents are a lot more defined, and they depend mostly on the shape of the plate tectonics. But this has revealed some critical issues with our tectonic plate simulation, like the low resolution and long blocky shapes which look nothing like Earth's plates. So let's fix that. We are generating our plates by picking some random points and then coloring the map based on what point is closest. This is called a Voronoi diagram. Then we split each region into a bunch of subpoints which all contribute to the same color but add some variety to the shape. The most obvious improvement would be to double the amount of subpoints, but that would also double the generation time. This is because right now for each and every pixel we have to cycle through all of the subpoints to find the closest one, which determines the color of the pixel. We can solve that by implementing a KD tree. We start by dividing the map vertically in two parts and keeping the part that contains our pixel while disregarding the other. We keep splitting the plane, essentially halving the number of candidate points each time, until we reach a section with just one point. We can now find the closest point in log n time, meaning that if we have 2 to the 20 points, we don't have to check a million of them, but just 20. So now that we can generate 100 times more points in a fraction of the time, we can get rid of these long plates, which occur when our initial points are too close together. Instead, I'm going to space them evenly apart and then merge some of the sections together. This looks a lot better, but the shapes are still very blocky, so this is the perfect moment to implement what many of you have requested, and that is continents drifting over time. I will simulate this by picking a random point in the plate, drawing up a radius until it meets a point of a different color, and then shifting the point in a random direction. All points inside the radius are then converted to that plate. Here we have that on our planet, and we can see the plates evolving with time. Repeating this a bunch of times leads to some awesome looking plates. And now that we have taken our plate tectonics from this to this, we have to figure out how to detect where these plates meet, which is harder than it sounds. These are crucial points because that's where our mountains spawn and where we transition smoothly from one continent to another. And since in this episode we'll be adding a player to walk around our planet, my simplistic edge detection algorithm with lots of inaccuracies won't work anymore. But I know how to fix it. Let's start with two points, connect them, and choose a width for our edge. The line that forms a 90 degree angle with this, and which is the same distance from both points, is called the perpendicular bisector, and it will end up being the edge that separates our plates. Now to check if a pixel is an edge pixel, we just project it onto that line, aka take a line parallel to our original which passes through the pixel and find the intersection. If the distance is less than the edge width, we have found an edge pixel.
Nice.
Then a third point enters the equation and ruins all the fun. The edge should look something like this, but the pixel that is here will perform all the steps and wrongly find that it is an edge pixel, not knowing that the edge ended earlier. Thankfully, we can solve this by finding the bisector between these two points and finding the intersection with the original bisector. Now, instead of projecting, we just use the distance from our pixel to this intersection. This shouldn't be too hard to implement. Here we go, you can see that we can accurately detect which pixels are in an edge. Now to smoothly transition between plates, we just use the distance we found, but for places where more than two plates meet, we will need to keep track of multiple distances. This shouldn't be too hard. And now we finally have a working edge detection algorithm that works even when multiple plates intersect. We can now apply the edge smoothing function to the noise map, which determines the height of our terrain, and we can see that even the transition from oceanic to continental plates is nice and gradual. Now we can just add a player to our world, and... oh. We need to increase the resolution of our planet. However, since Unity has a limit on the number of pixels per object, we can't keep having just one chunk per face. Instead, we will split each face into many smaller chunks. This also enables us to make another optimization which will truly unlock almost infinite resolution, but I'll get back to that one in a bit. For now, here is a far more detailed planet, and let's see what happens when we drop our player into the world now. We run into two big problems. The stuttering and lagging is happening because we are currently drawing all of the chunks all the time. Instead, we can only draw the chunks that are a certain distance from the player. The remaining chunks are not visible due to Earth's curvature anyways. The second issue is that this took almost 10 minutes to generate. But this is where the optimization I mentioned earlier comes into play. Typically, a chunk is generated by going through the pixels line by line. What if, instead, we generated it through a spiral? And at the end of each spiral, we check whether all of the pixels belong to the same plate. If no, we do another spiral. If yes, it's guaranteed that all remaining pixels will also have the same plate. So we can just fill them out, skipping all the complicated calculations. Here we can see that in action. All the red squares are pixels that we filled out without calculating anything. This optimization took the time to generate our planet from 10 minutes to just 20 seconds. Now the chunks generate almost instantly, we can make the chunk loading even better, after fixing some gravity issues. From now on, we will pre-generate a low-resolution version of our planet in a fraction of a second, which will be useful to us for many different reasons. Firstly, each low-res chunk covers multiple detailed chunks, and we can use it to approximate the highest point of each detailed chunk. Now, when we choose which chunks to render, we connect our player to the highest point of the chunk. If the line doesn't intersect our planet, we know that there is a clear line of sight to the chunk and we enable it. Otherwise, we can disable the chunk since it cannot be seen. And now our player can freely walk around the planet. And we even see mountain peaks far off in the distance. The oceans aren't exactly realistic, but this is something I'll work on in the next video of this 6-part series. For now, here's how the chunk rendering looks behind the scenes. Chunks with very high peaks are rendered even at a large distance, while some closer chunks are disabled, improving performance. However, this only works until we fly very high up, at which point we'd be, again, rendering too many chunks at once. In that situation, we can just replace the far-off chunks with the low-resolution variants. Now we can seamlessly fly into the sky without any noticeable chunk loading. Meanwhile, this is what's actually happening. Beautiful. Up to now, we focused on accuracy and performance. Now, let's make it all look pretty. First of all, I will replace the colors of our planet with slightly less saturated and more realistic variants. That looks a lot better. I also added some lighter regions where the water is shallow, which gives a nice look to the coastal areas. Next, I added a simple sun using some Voronoi noise, and I made it rotate around the planet. That doesn't look quite right. There we go. Now the sky is blue when it's day, and when the sun sets, it gradually transitions to night. It's time to finally improve the mountain generation. I'm going to re-enable the mountains that spawn at the tectonic plate intersections, but from now on, I'm going to check which types of plates intersect, since that influences the terrain. For example, if two continental plates collide head-on, this creates mountains, but if it's a continental and an oceanic, the oceanic plate will slide underneath the continental. There we go, we now have accurate tectonic plate boundaries and mountains spawn where they are supposed to. Now we can just add a bit of noise to the boundary values to make the mountains look more varied. Next, we want to get rid of these giant mountain clusters that often randomly spawn at the center of continents. If you remember, our terrain is generated by layering multiple octaves of smooth noise on top of each other. The first octave is the most responsible for the shape of our continents. And if we enable just that one, you will see that its smooth nature leads to our problem. So I will just remap the values of the first octave so that they can't go above a certain value, and that gets rid of these unnatural mountains. Now, the reason our mountains look so blobby is due to our best friend Perlin Noise.
You are the chosen one!
Its smooth nature has helped us a ton in the past, but it fails at emulating the sharp edges of a real mountain. These ridges are caused by millions of years of water running down the edge of the mountain, but actually simulating this wouldn't work for us. First of all, it's painfully slow. And secondly, the whole world needs to be generated at once in detail for this to work. Meanwhile, our chunks all need to be generated independently from one another. So after researching a bunch of other techniques, and all of them didn't work for some reason or another, I developed my own technique that I'm calling fractal ridge blending. First, we need to detect where our mountains should be, and this is determined by our regular Perlin noise simulation. Using this, we can add a few extra octaves of noise to just our mountain areas, which gives them a lot more detail. Now for the ridges. Our noise function looks something like this, smoothly giving values between 0 and 1. First, we can shift it down like this. Then we apply an absolute value, meaning every negative value becomes the positive equivalent. Then we flip it and readjust it such that it still gives values between 0 and 1. The absolute value has made a sharp edge, which, when applied to our terrain, gives us ridge-like shapes. Now, like always, we can add multiple octaves of this special noise for more detail, and then we only apply this noise where our original function determined that there should be mountains. Finally, we don't want a sudden change, but instead we smoothly blend between our purlin noise and ridge noise. And now our mountains look a lot more realistic. I still want to improve a few things, mainly with how the snow spawns. Firstly, I use the fact that we have a temperature map and the temperature decreases with altitude, so we can just assign a minimum temperature below which the terrain turns to ice. And now there is a lot less snow in desert mountains while the polar ones are covered in it. I also made it so that the terrain smoothly blends into the mountain, and this is how that looks. Finally, we can check the steepness of the terrain and only spawn the snow on the flatter parts, which gives an even more natural look to the mountain peaks. In the next video, we'll be improving the oceans and generating some rivers, so subscribe so you don't miss out on that. But until then, you can try out the free build of this tool on itch.io. There will be a link in the description. I'll also link some articles if you want to read more about the topics we discussed, but you can always join the Discord server if you want to chat about something in more detail. This video took over 2 months to make, and it wouldn't be possible without your support, so thanks once again, and I'll see you in part 3.